Okay, so what I'm going to talk to you is a quick presentation which I had these thoughts and I presented part of this, not fully this presentation, at the ISA forum, which I lead in India, around a month back. But this presentation is a much more fleshed out version of that. And one of the challenges, as most of you are from the media and communication industry, one of the challenges all of us are facing and one of the times that we are all living in is that this is a digital revolution age. And most marketeers and most communication professionals are really finding that while connectedness and digital world gives a huge amount of opportunities, what is the right space for the legacy marketing methods and what is the right space between the methodologies that we've learned and how to adapt connectedness? And one of the pieces which we have been debating a lot at Godrej itself, and also I know a lot of other organizations are trying to find their way through, is that while on one hand connectedness gives you so much of new opportunities, it also throws a lot of paradoxes, especially for organizational leaders. And the intent of this presentation is not to, first of all, paradoxes doesn't mean that one is right or one is wrong. One thing is very clear, that connectedness is here to stay. This is a new way of living. We are in a completely new generation. We are in a completely new revolution. And actually, we should be thankful and really, I think humble while we accept this magical change which is happening around us. But what I'm going to take you through is some seven paradoxes which I see, which I as a leader, my own organization, and I can talk for many advertisers across the country and the world who are grappling with. And these are some thoughts which I see is what I call as the connectedness paradox. Move from there. So there's seven paradoxes which I think which we are all grappling with. First is what I call as scale versus intimacy, and I'll talk about each of them in detail. Second is data versus insight. Michelle, will you move? It's not, let me just do this. Okay. Micro-targeting versus privacy. It's a very, very big debate which we are having today. The next one is human interaction versus digital touch. Established scale brands versus insurgents. I can tell you this is an amazing challenge that we are all seeing. I'm going to talk a little bit in detail. The whole paradox of insurgency that we are facing. And actually, I love this word, insurgency. This is obviously a short-term versus long-term, which always plays in any change. And the last one is, which I think as leaders, the biggest one we are facing is how to transform legacy organizations into agile organizations. So let me just start with the first one, scale versus intimacy. Let me just see, Michelle, if I can just control from here. Let me see, it moves. I think I would have pointed there. As marketeers, and this is a thing that we've been talking a lot in the last 4 months in our organization, we are all taught a certain way of marketing. And one thing which I tell my marketing team is that, I'm lucky that I'm not a brand manager today. And I moved out of marketing long time back. Because today's marketing is a very, very different way of being. I also tell them, the next generation of brand managers which is going to come in, let's say, or which are already moving into marketing for the first time, who are going to do their first marketing stints, or people who are going to come in the next generations, are going to be seamless new marketeers. The challenge for organization lies with the current, group of marketeers who over the last 10, 15 years have grown with a certain way of marketing. And this current set, which is in leadership position in marketing, which is in, let's say, middle-level positions in marketing, are the group which is grappling the most. Because they have been taught a certain way of brand building, and that is a mass media-led mass building. What this meant was always that you have a very large-scale mass proposition. We are all taught, I don't know how many of you are from media agencies or have some brush with media, we are taught about this large reach and frequency optimization models. It's all about scale. In fact, I think these are two classic examples, and I can put my own many examples of GCPL. I think we all would, even though many of you may not have seen the first ads of these brands, but I think most of us would remember these iconic brands like Nirma and Cadbury's, which are built on few campaigns, The Nirma jingle is something which is still, if you just close your eyes, it will vibrate in your, ears. Now, this is the kind of way we all learned marketing. Now, the challenge for organizations, the first paradox is, this still has huge reach. TV is still the largest medium. It is still the most cost-effective medium. So you can't give it up. The first paradox comes is, okay, how much we do this versus the new personalized brand building form, which is emerging. This is a completely new way which is emerging, which is today, you can actually do bespoke messaging to consumers at a personal level. There's a direct line of sight, which we never have in a mass media advertising of actually the moment you throw a message, you can actually look at whether there's a conversion happening or no of the consumer. Oh, this is a delight and a challenge in itself. And obviously, there is emerging a possibility of one-to-one relationships. Now, this is a new way of working. At the same time, the challenge with this new way of working right now is these models are still not fully established. These models are still not fully proven. And obviously, there are many, I mean, this one brilliant example which I think Cadbury does is that today you can go online and create a gifting pack of your own with your own personalized name and a message and you can deliver it. Now, these are the new ways of doing marketing. This looks very exciting and it is likely to become much, much bigger. The first challenge, let me tell you, as marketeers and as organization, we are grappling what I call is the scale versus intimacy. How much money to put behind the scale, which is still cost effective? We have to learn this. We are grappling to learn this. What is the right balance? And how do we build skills for this without, you know, forgetting the scale still? Because scale is also the advantage of any organizations. So that's what I call the first big paradox that we're facing. In fact, you know, so much so, there's a very nice line we have crafted and which I read also somewhere. Today, to my mind, one line to ask to many marketing people is, just like when you learn a driving car, you need first a learner license and then finally a confirmed license. The challenge which today's marketers are facing and the question which is to be asked is, do you have license to be a marketer today? Because all of us maybe need to get fresh learner licenses. And that's, I think, the first challenge of scale versus intimacy. The second is, I think, with the famous quote, which I think, I love that quote, but I have a counterpoint on that quote, which I'm struggling right now. Data is the new oil. I think this is the quote which, you know, Mr. Ambani said in his vision around a few years back. He said, this will be my new oil. And I have no doubt about this. Data is something which is coming through our ears. It's the talk of the town at every forum. And we're seeing the way India is consuming data is crazy. I don't want to throw any numbers here because you would have heard this, you know, terabytes, gigabytes, all those numbers all over the place. How India is adopting data, and it is still early days because India has still not moved into 4G fully, 5G is on the anvil, and this is going to, obviously, this is making a new life happen for us. This is what's really happening, it's daunting. Let me tell you the new skills that, which are coming in place, which some of us all are adapting is things like DMPs. Now, this is becoming a very critical tool or something what we call as data management platforms. For a company which is in consumer products business and not a technology company like us, even for companies like us, owning our own data, consumer data, is a new way of being. Because otherwise, I can tell you, CPG and FMCG companies are primarily built on outsourcing data. Because we only pick up extrapolated data from multiple syndicated agencies like Kantar, Household Panel, Nielsen, Millward Brown. We never own data because our consumers are in millions spread across the vast nook and corner of the country. We can't own that data anyway, unlike a telecom company which has consumer data on their network. But that's changing. Today, very clearly it's becoming a new thing to us is that you'll have to create your own data management platforms and try to create mirror images and lookalikes of your own consumer data. It may not be the full representation of your universe, but you'll have to create maybe sampled pieces of universe for yourself. So this is a new skill which is coming in place of data. Let me tell you, we in-house have started building new skills and new jobs called data scientists. This is a term which never existed 5 years back. This is a term which is associated with a lot of analytics companies. But today, most CPG companies are starting looking around and acquiring the skill called the new people called data scientists. And analytics is a new way of being. So this is a very clear reality which is facing us, that we as CPG companies have to start owning data which never belonged to us. But at the same time, let me tell you, there is a trick in this. It's not as simple as that. Because as we are using data, we are finding one dichotomy, which is one paradox which is happening, and which is precise. Yes, data is a new oil, but you want to have an oil spill in the organization, right? You all know when oil spills, it's a mess. And that's one challenge that I'm telling you all of us will face. Data can be very exciting. And I'm already seeing when we get so much of data every day on our social listening platforms, which we've created in-house, suddenly we get inundated with data. But the skill that we need, and that's a paradox, is that while you need data, you don't want to get drowned in the spill. And One quote I read which is so brilliant, you can keep on strangulating data till actually data will tell you what you want to hear. And that's a very big risk and paradox, that when you have just humongous data and data, you will actually somehow find what you want to hear. The reality is, the trick lies and the paradox lies in use data to actually generate insight. And the paradox is data is not insight. Insight is getting meaningful information out of data. And the paradox is how much of data, but using that data, not leading to paralysis, and still having and retaining that skill of picking up the relevant insight out of data. And one paradox I can tell you, and one challenge which always will remain with us, no matter how much data we get, insights finally come by interacting with humans directly. There's a difference between getting data and getting insights. And finally, meaningful success happens through insights and not through raw data. And insights happen through connectedness with consumers, with customers. And that is one paradox that I can tell you, the second one we're reading. We can't ignore data. There is no debate that there's a new model emerging. How much of that to build without losing that whole skill of insighting? So that I think is the second big paradox. The third one is this whole great piece of micro-targeting, which I think is a fantastic tool which is emerging. And I call it that it is the new toy and it's the new joy. You know, it's like many of us, when you get new toys, when you're young, you'll go mad about playing with a new toy. Let me tell you, micro-targeting, the new toy of most marketers, that it's an amazing phenomena how you can actually just go and do a consumer profiling, I mean, sitting at home. And you can get with so much of information, you can actually create lookalikes with consumers. I mean, I didn't know this skill. I've seen my digital managers do it, and it just hits me, hey, what's this? I can actually profile my 10 different profiles of consumers of granularity, which I never thought existed. We were always stuck at demographics and at best psychographics. And here you can actually get into preferences, habits, and actual purchase pattern, and then profile a consumer. Now, that's as intimate as you can get. So that's a real big joy, I can tell you, because it really, really makes you get so much of endless possibilities as a marketing company. Then the second piece is, we have all been, I'm sure, victim of this. You can get retargeted like crazy till you yield or till you do something else. I mean, this is a brilliant example which I use. You know, this is a horse and hound is actually it's a website for, you know, horse lovers. It's a British website. It is the Bible of, you know, people who follow this, you know, sport. You can buy, sell horses also on this. And see, what is the ad on that, actually? There's an Amazon advertising selling a product which has nothing to do with horses. That means they would have actually profiled people who are, you know, likely consumers of this product, and that they have an interest and preference in horses, and you're getting retargeted on a most unlikely of platforms. No other marketing would have taught you this. Now, this is the joy and the toy and the joy that lies with this, right? So this is a brilliant piece, and we must all learn this, this retargeting. But at the same time, one paradox which is parallel emerging is the privacy challenge. What is that fine line when retargeting becomes hounding the consumer? Because finally, you can't be hounding your consumer. At some stage, the consumer will get pissed off, and the consumer will get irritated. We all must have been victim to this, and we must have also got irritated when, at the most unlikely of sites, I am just getting hounded to something which may have searched maybe 15 days back, or maybe I would have just cursorily searched as well. So I think that persuasion and irritation is a very fine line to understand when you get this new tool and this new skill set with you. There is also proven research which are emerging that beyond a point, retargeting becomes futile. And that's a new field which we have been checking also, which is throwing up data that it's a very, very big mistake if you just keep on hounding consumers beyond a point. In fact, linked to this also is the concern, second one which is emerging, which is all known, is the privacy concerns. We know this can lead to huge consumer safety issues. We've heard enough cases of today, the kind of pressure and the backlash which Facebook is in, where they have been using consumer data for, you know, purposes which they are not supposed to use. So this privacy is a second big concern, and this can be a very big backlash on companies if you end up by chance, by mistake, using consumer data for purposes they're not supposed to use it for. So this is a second paradox, that one, you must learn this new skill of micro-targeting, but at the same time, what is the fine line between retargeting and hounding? Where does this become irritation? And secondly, how do you, as a company, while you're creating these profiles, while you're doing this whole digital marketing, ensure consumer safety and privacy? And this is going to get tougher. This, to my mind, I think, is the single biggest compliance risk which CEOs and companies run today, that you get caught up at the wrong end of a privacy leak. It can be one of the biggest reputational risks that any organization can run it. And we've seen how, you know, still the compliances, laws, the governing laws are not very strong. Europe has taken the first step in GDPR. America is still to craft this in a very meaningful way. Indian privacy law is on hold because I guess the new government is going to come and do something about it. This is a very big paradox. Learn that skill, but how to respect this. There's one very interesting example I want to tell you. WeChat, in one of the researches in China, and I forgot to talk about this, and there's a company which is, we all know about WeChat, I mean, a great messaging innovation which has happened. They have realized through a lot of research that if they send more than 2 messages in a day to the consumer, it becomes futile as well as irritating. So they have now decided to limit messages to 2 in a day. In India, a recent research said that Indian consumers still not that intolerant. And we in India are still pretty lax in terms of privacy. We all know that. So Indian consumers are still very tolerant of getting bombarded, and they willingly still share their mobile numbers across, right? But that's going to change very soon. The fourth one is, we all love these terms called machine learning, artificial intelligence, driverless cars, and whatnot will happen, and it's going to happen. I mean, we can't run away from it, we have to be part of it. That's I'm pretty clear. The question is, what's the paradox and the right balance between human interaction and digital? Now, digital is clearly opening new possibilities. I mean, we all know this. I mean, I'm sure all of you have been to Nykaa, most of the women especially who've been here, right? Oh, what it does, what kind of endless possibilities of brands it opens up. I mean, Uber, we can't live without Uber or Ola today. What a convenience. No doubt an amazing amount of new way of life has come through digital. And this is all giving us limitless choices and brands, convenience, a different sense of freedom. This is a new way of human life. And this is here. This is what we adopt. The question here is, this is digital, but where is the balance of human interaction that we must parallelly maintain? Because one hand, while Uber is changing lives, we also know that Uber also faces the biggest issues of driver protest and driver unrest. And today, if any one of us will ever give up using Uber and next time say I want to do Ola, it would not be only because the Uber app didn't work. It is more likely to happen because of the behavior of the driver or what the driver did to us, right? So that interface of that brilliant digital platform called Uber still remains the driver. Your delight is not only about the Uber app. Finally, you end up rating the ride experience per se, right? Which has got a lot to do with the timing, the service of the car, and how the driver behaved. So remember this, while that technology becomes more and more important, the human interaction is a paradox will maintain. That piece finally will always be at the forefront of it. One clear example of which I told you the word, the second one is, in India today, while e-commerce is going through the roof, at the same time, one big change which has happened, which never happened till first 15 years of modern trade in India. Today, the modern trade is booming in India. The way it's growing, it's never grown earlier. So that's a very interesting paradox, that consumers are willing to buy apparels and shoes, which have all to go with, got to do with appearance online, which we never thought will ever happen. But at the same time, they are willing to step into modern trades and pick up brands and that get that whole experience of touching, feeling brands and interacting with maybe the store staff and the promoters. Today, a lot of beauty brands have realized that one hand, the Nykaas will happen, but the second biggest investment which most beauty brands are today doing are in a phenomena called beauty advisors, which are nothing but trained professionals who today are educating consumers in store about your brands. So just see, this is an interesting challenge and paradox. On one hand, you are following the whole model of machine-led, consumer profiling-led way of selling, but at the same time, there's a beauty advisor phenomena which is becoming the biggest investment area because consumers are seeking more and more information. And all information need not get, while on one hand you'll try to do videos to explain this, there's finally that human touch which explains it in a very different way. and both investments are happening very parallelly. That's a very important paradox. So you see a Nykaa emerging, at the same time a Nykaa also opening up their stores. Last week we had the founder of this brand called Wow, which I'm going to talk a little bit in our one of our conferences. And he was very clear. He says, while I've become such a big phenomena online, I think the offline market is so big that I cannot ignore it. And they're talking of looking at opening Wow stores. So this is a great paradox, that how you become more and more machine learning led, but same time human interaction taking a new form. Like Beauty Advisor, a different form of human interaction than what we are all used to selling. So that's the fourth paradox which is emerging. The last one, which is very true to all of us, is scale brands versus insurgents. And I love this term called insurgents. Well, insurgents are here. And they are really hitting all the scale brands and challenging them in their own way. No debate about that. And we should be humble enough to admit that, hey, this is a new phenomenon happening. One thing which has clearly happened, the two biggest barriers which CPG companies held always was an entry barrier of creating large-scale distribution. Second was building brands over time. They're both weakening. There are new models emerging very clearly. E-commerce, chains like Cash and Carry are throwing up completely new alternate channels of distribution. So that barrier is weakened. Obviously, digital is a new way of building equities. There's a changing consumer behaviors. Consumers are more prone to experimentation. They don't mind trying out new things. These new insurgent brands have something at their core which scale brands don't have, and that's a digital mindset. Their models are woven around being digital. That's their way of being, that's their DNA, which most legacy brands don't have. And the third, as a result, since they're smaller, they behave differently, they're very agile. And that's where they call it insurgents. And the biggest case study on this is Wow. I guess most of you heard about this. Do you want to take a guess how big is this brand now? It's a 4 to 5 year old brand. So let me just tell you, this is a brand run by, we met them recently only. This is a brand run by two sets of two brothers each, right? So four of them run it, two brothers each. And very humble beginnings. And this is a brand which they stumbled upon, they struggled, and finally they reached here in, that's a long story in itself. It's a brand which is around 120 odd crores in a matter of 5 years. Not a small number in CPG business. And the biggest thing is, this brand has got 50% of its turnover coming from US and 50% from India. And they have, on Amazon, become the largest market share brand of shampoos, beating P&G and Unilever with all their might. That's a big one. And they are on their way to, in a certain segment of hair color shampoos, becoming the second largest brand in the US market online on Amazon. This is a very different insurgency, taking on the mights of brands built by P&G and Unilever over centuries, you know. And here comes a brand in 4 years' time. I mean, these people are from a place called Tumkur in Karnataka, right? They come upon this, they're not even Americans, they don't even understand the US way of life, that culture. They're trying to, what the story they're saying, they're trying to still set up a two-member team in Canada right now, right? And this insurgency, no P&G Unilever would have ever predicted that they will get an insurgency happening from a place called Tumkur in India, right? And that's what's happened. Now, this is a great challenge which is emerging. Now, while these insurgents are here, the challenge for our scale brands is what do? Now, there are multiple options here, you know. One thing is very clearly, all of us have to reinvent, and that's a real paradox in front of us. But what do? I think there are two paradoxes which face us, and I can tell you, there's something we're debating a lot and trying to do something about it. One thing is, we have to redefine what scale means to us. That we always had a huge advantage on distribution, we had a huge advantage on mass media investments, but we'll have to rethink, how do we manage, what is this new scale it can be used for? One example, does it mean that we can get into a very different partnerships with modern trade retailers or e-commerce platforms? Use our might to get new partnerships that are so different? We don't know, that's one possibility, right? But redefining the scale is clearly one way to go. But the second paradox is we have three choices as scale brands. That we need to become parents of choice, and that's a very interesting term, you know, that we need to become parents to some of these insurgents. The question is how? One is you become a partner to innovate with them, and which is something like, you know, this Unilever Foundry. How many of you heard of this term, Unilever Foundry? Okay, if you've not heard, please go and search easily once you go out of the conference on Unilever Foundry. There's a platform which Unilever globally has created, where they invite and partner with startups and do a lot of pilots for their scale brands to use digital technologies and reach out meaningfully to consumers. They're not clear what where will it lead us. But at any given time, when you go to the Unilever Foundry, there's some hundreds of pilots happening, which they share, and some of the case studies they do share. Now, this is becoming a partner to innovate with people who you know have the skill and you don't have, with some of these insurgents. It's an interesting model. The second one is invest and become a venture capitalist. I mean, you obviously have scale, you have funds, so you go and actually invest into some of these startups, insurgent brands, and say, okay, I'll learn along with them. For example, we've seen brands like Beardo, et cetera, have got invested into by, you know, FMCG companies. Or for that matter, you know, the last model is acquiring insurgents, which is the biggest example is Dollar Shaving Club, which Unilever got and bought out of trade. This is a very important paradox, that what do we do? Do we say the course as being a scale brand but redefine our scale, or do we become a parent of choice? But you have to do something. You can't just let insurgency happen, because finally you'll be blown out. Short-term versus long-term, the sixth and the second last paradox. Data-driven approach teaches us completely new way of marketing, which I say that you have to have a new license to be a marketeer. No debate about that. We have to learn this. But one thing which I'm sensing is the data-driven approach has a short-termness to it, because most of this is here and now. So for example, it's all about click-through rates. It's about some new terms that we're talking of. How is about conversion marketing? And the third piece is 10-second videos. Facebook tells us 6-second videos. In fact, you know, we started hearing terms on 0-second videos. You know, we were at some forum and saying, how do you build a brand in 0 second or 1 second? It just comes and goes. You see these GIFs happening, your brand comes and it goes. But this is an interesting way. I mean, this new thinking altogether. This data-driven approach is obviously leading and revolutionizing the way we all do business. But one question which still I've not been able to answer, and I've talked to a lot of people and nobody has an answer, obviously, that is still a paradox of these beautiful times, is how will you build brand through this, right? Because finally, brand equities are built over long term. That science, I don't think so, is going to change. Right? I don't think so brand assets can be built in 10-second videos. I don't think so click-through rates are going to create long-term brand equities. Now, that's a very large paradox, which I'm still grappling with, that the second one, in fact, in this world is very important. One thing we're realizing, that 30-second old way of working of ours is not going to work. The consumers today want to know among each product, what is the ingredient in this? Each consumer has become very conscious. Oh, how much of natural? How much of no chemicals? I want to know what you put in this. But the moment on one hand, your consumer is asking for more education, and we're seeing the roots of brand advertiser happening, the less is a 6-second advertising going to do anything for you, right? So that's a very big paradox. And I'm convinced that it has to be finally a balance of both. Because while conversion marketing is definitely going the right way, you can't let go of building brand equities. That's a long-term exercise. Finally, brands like, you know, I mean, these iconic brands of one of our own, of Good Night and Coke, they're not built only through conversion marketing. They would have never got built through conversion marketing, this I can tell you. They will have to be built through very clearly multiple touch points of engagement. I'm not saying that the brand are going to get built through 30-second advertising. That too I've already questioned as the first paradox. But the brand are not going to get through only short-term conversion marketing. There has to be investment over education, investment over engagement on multiple fronts, in fact. And this long-term we cannot forget. So there's this whole short-term versus long-term. Here and now sale on e-commerce versus consistent engagement across multiple brands, which obviously will not give you result overnight. So that's a very big paradox which we will face, and we are. How much to balance that? And last, I think, is the organization level, which we are at a CEO level, you grapple the most. The agility is here to stay. This is a new world. No debate. These insurgents are changing your life. They're disrupting your business models. I mean, we'll be fools to say that, hey, they won't do anything to us. This is a very, very real challenge and threat that is happening across legacy organizations. And one debate which in my mind has been there is that large organizations are always built on two very big parameters that we have optimized in our models. One is the cost of capacity. The second is cost of capability, getting the right talent, building the right capability. And we optimize this and then create huge scale around this. But one thing which these new models are teaching us and which I can tell you we have never looked at that, is the cost of delay. I mean, today, like this Wow guy was telling us, and I can be very honest to share, our NPD cycles on innovation, and we at GCPL have been rated as by Forbes as the 25th most innovative company in the world. And we pride ourselves on our innovation cycles, right? And last 7 years when we've been so successful, 1/3 of our growth has been driven by new products. Our innovation cycles at the fastest would take 18 months, right? At best, sometimes we crack a product from idea to launch maybe 13, 14 months. Wow guy was telling us that they are right now testing 108 products. And they believe only 5 will work out of that. And they will launch it in 6 months. It's a very different model. I mean, they don't do the consumer research, maybe the way. When you talk to them, how do you consumer researches? The way they do consumer researches, they'll put a just ad on the internet. They'll just take a consumer feedback. They'll change it next day. Oh, that's a very different way of being. And they're willing to live with 108 small products getting launched and 103 failing out of it, and just 5 succeeding. Right? This cost of delay of 13 months versus 4 months, I guess we don't bother about it. And that's a new way of being. This is a paradox. There's a cost we need to start thinking. And we're thinking, what's the cost of delay? Second, keep it, I think there's a point which I had to put, which I missed here. The second piece is, one bottleneck that all legacy organizations are realizing, that while we talk a lot of agility, in a human body, you can say my mind is fully agile. I want to give this example of my body. I've decided today to be fully agile in my mind. I've strengthened my leg muscle the most because I want to run the fastest, let's say, time on marathon, right? My legs are fully fit. My mind is fully agile. But at the same time, if I've not made sure that my heart is healthy, which is going to pump in the bloods to my legs when I run, I will never be successful. So you have to be fully fit and agile as a body to successfully run a marathon. You can't be just doing only lower body exercises and while eating most of the wrong things, which give you fat around your belly and which make your heart, sick and say, you know, my calf muscles are the strongest and I think I'm running a marathon. It'll never happen. What this analogy tells is, a legacy organization is only as agile as its least most agile function. I can have the most agile marketing team and have a very slow supply chain team. It doesn't mean anything. I can have a most agile sales team and a very least agile HR team. I'll fail. And that's a challenge we are all facing as legacy organizations, that we are only as agile as our least agile function. And we are doing a lot of these experiments of creating agile teams. But what we have to think is, how do we move from being departmentally agile or experimentally agile to actually becoming an agile organization? This is a fundamental DNA change. And this is a paradox. We are doing, I can tell you, we are thinking a lot on this experimental agile organization, which is nothing wrong. Because we're so large, and most of us are so large, it's not in our DNA. We have to find maybe through experiments. But finally, the success and the paradox which lies with us is we retain our legacy but become fully agile organization. That's the largest big paradox. So I think this is where, you know, 7 things which what I call is the connectedness paradox, which is there. It's a fantastic paradox time. I can tell you in my career, I've never seen this happen. We've always fought competition. We've always fought, hardcore marketing battles, hardcore cost battles. But what this is doing is, this is making us really reach out into new depths of ourselves and rethink what we need to do. And that's the connectedness paradox. I think I'm very thankful that I'm living in these challenging times. I'm thankful that actually I'm at the helm of an organization where I can make meaningful difference when I'm leading the organization through such a paradoxical time. But this is where it is. And let's just enjoy this time of connectedness paradox. I'm sure we'll all find our ways through this. And that will be our success. So thank you so much.
So in your insights about...
Where are you? Can you raise your hand?
Hi, it's Joel from Archetype. You mentioned about, in your paradox about data versus insights, you spoke about how insights are now being generated more through people interactions. However, we tend to know of it about insights being generated through analysis, analytics, etc. So I just wanted to understand your rationale behind that.
Yeah, okay. You know, I said insights, and the word insight, there's always a difference between data analytics and insight. And what I meant is that that's the difference we are still missing out. We're getting so joyful about this data, and data is doing such beautiful, meaningful analysis to us that we need to be careful what is analytics and what is insight. I'll give you an example. Data analysis can tell you, and it's a live example which has happened with us in one of our NPDs. And let me tell you this. Actually, let me give this live example. How many of you have heard of this product called PowerChip, which we launched? Okay, if you have not heard it, you know what it is? It's a small chip. It's an electric machine of insights. Can I have the other mic, hand mic? Because I want to just explain. And there's a very classical difference between data analysis and insight. A very live one which has happened with us. Okay. You know, you all know the Goodknight liquid vapor as a machine. So we launched this low-cost machine for rural areas, or middle India as we call it, which is again another electric machine. And instead of that refill, it's a small chip, kind of a gel chip, which goes in that machine and it gets evaporated and it gives you, mosquito repellency. We did a huge amount of data researches on this, right? We actually did both online research as through mobiles as well as obviously standard data researches. And two research rounds happened where we fine-tuned everything, or the marketing piece, product, everything. Finally, we went to the market. Everything seemed okay. That chip which is there is a small, this kind of a piece in which there's a gel. And on top of that is a plastic film. And you're supposed to insert it as is in the machine slot, and it generates heat and it evaporates. You know what came out after 6 months of launch? 80% of consumers are using that product wrong. No amount of data told us this. And what happened when we went and then asked consumers, what are you using wrong? They're taking that film off. They're not supposed to take that film off. They're just supposed to insert the film, right? And this is a very specific usage insight. And I can tell you, no amount of online this consumer feedback, no amount of offline work told us, right? Then we realized, this is ridiculous. You are not supposed to take the film. Where this insight would have got picked up, if you had done actually in situ observation research, that you would have gone to consumers and placed it with them and sat through when he or she is using it. And this thing. And just would have observed it without even telling the consumer. Now this is a human interaction. Will you just let consumer be and say, batao kaise use kar rahe ho? So I'm saying no amount of data will, so this, we had great data, but I can tell you we never anticipated ki somebody will take the film off that. And 70% consumers are using it wrong. I mean, we went so wrong. This is insight. So all I'm saying is, there are many times data will give you right insight itself. I'm not saying data can't give you, but there are a lot of insights which will still come through human interactions. Don't lose sight of that. Like, to my mind, if I were to take an example of Uber, and if I were to be Uber CEO, actually I'm a technology platform. I can get every single data as a company Uber sitting on my, laptop of what happened on every ride, how many stars came out, right? What is the happiness score of consumer? Right, how my drivers are rating the consumers. Everything comes through, right? What timing happened, all my cost factors, everything can come out. But still, I think no insight can come until the Uber CEO actually says, I want to take 10 rides with different random drivers of my own, right? And that interaction of a ride where he or she interacts with a live car as a passenger, right? And experiences the condition of the car, experiences the behavior of the driver, experiences what happens actually in a ride, no data will tell you. That you can't miss. So I'm saying that both things have to coexist.